special physics lecture to be given by Professor Yoshiyuki Yamaguchi from Kyoto University in Japan. So we are very pleased that he is visiting us. This is his first visit. He and his wife has come, and this is their first visit to India. So we are elated that they chose to come here. And okay, so I'll just tell you briefly about his academic career. So Yoshi, he got his PhD from Nagoya University in 98, and then for a year he was a postdoc in Ritshumeikan University, and then from then on he is now on the faculty of Kyoto University in Japan. Kyoto University, I understand it's the second biggest university in the whole of Japan. And his research areas are in nonlinear dynamics and condensed matter physics. He has worked on mainly Hamiltonian dynamics of long-range interacting systems and couple map lattices and different aspects of nonlinear dynamical systems. A bit of personal reminiscence. I know Yoshi since, I guess, 2011. I met him when he was visiting with his wife, Lyon, a city in France. At that time, I was a postdoc there. And it so happened that we first met in a Japanese restaurant. It was supposed to be a Japanese restaurant, but we had gone together to have lunch. And it was known to us as a Japanese restaurant, but after going there with him and his wife, we discovered that it was not Japanese. So he said that, okay, because of facial similarity, it was not Japanese, maybe Vietnamese or something. But anyway, from then on, we kept on discussing physics and like other things on and off. And this year, in fact, we collaborated, we wrote a paper together. And it's a real pleasure that he's here. He's one of the most knowledgeable guys I know in nonlinear dynamics. So feel free to interact with him while he's here. He is here until Sunday. And so feel free to interact with him. And by the way, he has also fallen in love with the Indian food, the Bengali food. Apparently, he told me that every day he is eating the meal of two persons. Okay, so he has fallen, those taste buds probably were not activated, so they got activated after coming here. And he has equilibrated quite well with more or less the whole of Calcutta, I would say, and also Belur. He could find his way to the mall and this and that. So he's enjoying the physics part, I guess. I hope so, and also the general ambience and so on.
What is 1 over f fluctuation? concerning the time series x of t is such as this, blah, 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 blah. And then we consider the Fourier transform of x of t. So it is written by the children. And we take a square root of this Fourier transform. So it is the power spectrum of time series x of t. And then the definition of f1 over x fluctuation like this, this power spectrum is depend on f as a power law, and the exponent is between the 0 to 2, then we say it is 1 over x fluctuation. Of course, this exponent should be 1, but extended the definition. So 1 over x fluctuation should be 1, but from 0 to 2, I say this is 1 over x fluctuation. Okay? What means the 1 over x fluctuation? I presented two quantities. This is the power spectrum, and this is autocorrelation function. And these two quantities have a relation by the Fourier transform, by Wiener-Hinching theorem. So it says the Fourier transform power spectrum is an autocorrelation function. And the Fourier transform of autocorrelation function is power spectrum. Okay? So for instance, we consider the correlation function is delta. So it means that this time series is immediately forget the information at the next step. So this is a delta correlation function. And Fourier transform this delta, delta correlation function gives f power to minus zero power spectrum. And this is called white noise. So if we write down the graph of this power spectrum, it is flat. So this is a white noise. And the next short time correlation is exponential decaying correlation. So it is very fast, passive decay. And the Fourier transform, this exponential correlation function gives the so-called Lorentzian power spectrum. And the Lorentzian is like this. So if echo is very small, we cannot enable this part. So this power spectrum should be the constant, almost constant. And if echo is very very large, then yes, we can neglect this part. So we have f power to minus 2. And here is a time scale determined by this constant gamma. Okay, so I excluded the 0, exponent 0 and 2 from 1 over f fluctuation because it is not so special. And the special thing is like this. If we, the correlation is decay in the logarithmically, algebraically, so it is a very long correlation. Then we have f power to minus mu power spectrum. So comparing with this white noise, this type of power spectrum is also called a pink noise. And the exponent is not 0, not 2, and it is between 0 to 2. No, I'm concerned with continuous time. It depends on the consideration because f large limit means very short time. So if the observing system because the large FC means the short time region. So if we observe the observation precision is not so high, we cannot observe the very very high fluctuation. So
some
So normally we have some nothing happen for F large and nothing happen for F small. call, and the intermediate rate, then we have this kind of one-way fluctuation. I will show you the example. And there's many examples of one-way fluctuation. And this one, so horizontal axis shows the logarithmic of frequency f. And vertical axis is the logarithmic of power spectrum. So if S power spectrum is proportional to F to minus mu, then taking logarithmic in the left-hand side and right-hand side, we say the logarithmic S is equal proportional to minus mu logarithmic F. So if we have the power spectrum like a power log, then we should have the straight line in the log plot. Okay, and the slope, if slope is minus one, then it says exactly one by fluctuation. And this example is a vacuum tube, so noise in the vacuum tube. And this is a semiconductor, and this is human heart, and this is Scott giant axion. I'm not sure what happened. And these are brain activities, and this is a Brandenburg concert. So here is a sound, time series of sound of the concert. It says one-way fluctuation, and it's a human time estimation. So there are many examples of systems which show the one-way fluctuation. So the type of the system is so large, the physical system and human activity, so human activity here, and brain and music. So it's too wide. So in this talk, we concentrate on collective motion in large Hamiltonian systems having long-range interactions. Okay. So by focusing the target, I have showed a rather clear explanation of the source of one-way fluctuation. So I start from the explanation of what is long-range. So Shamit said I'm studying long range interaction, and we have a long range interaction between the Japan and India. So it is one example of long range interaction. So I explained the definition of long range interaction. So we consider the spatial dimension D. So this space is here and here and here. So we have three dimensions. So in this space, we have a D equals 3. And then we consider interaction potential for distance r. So you know the Coulomb force and gravitation force. And in that case, the potential is power proportional to r minus r power to minus 1. So this exponent alpha is 1. And we consider the contribution from far away. So we consider the integration from the all over the world. And then the estimation is like this. If alpha is not D, then this integration is proportional R to power to D minus alpha. And then if alpha is for D, it's a logarithmic D. So if alpha, this is alpha, alpha is smaller than the spatial dimension D, then this integration diverges. So in this case, we say this is long-range interaction. And if alpha is greater than D, then we say this integration does not diverge, so we say this is short-range. So for instance, if interaction is nearest neighbor, so interaction is restricted in the next the person, only next person, then integration does not diverge, so it is short range. And of course, gravitation and the Coulomb force is spatial dimension D equals 3, and alpha is 1, so alpha is 1 is here, so it is long range. Okay.
So,
value of D? So it depends on the system. So, in our universe, the partial dimension is 3. Okay, so this x, x and y after x and y and z. So this is 3 dimension. And later I introduced one example of system which have the partial dimension 1. Okay. And so this is a schematic picture of the discrepancy between the long range area and short range area. So if alpha is smaller than d, then it is long range. And as I said, a typical example of short range is nearest neighbor, because if alpha equals alpha goes to infinite, then the interaction stops at r equal 1. Because if r equals r is greater than 1, then r equals greater than 1 power to minus infinite is 0. So integration does not diverge. So this is a typical example of nearest neighbor, a typical example of short range. And a typical example of long range type is mean field. Mean field is the all-to-all interaction with equal weight. So equal weight means the interaction force does not depend on the distance r. So it does not depend on distance r means the alpha should be 0. Then here, alpha equals 0, so this is the long range interaction. So there are two typical examples of long range and short range. And the physical examples of short long range interaction system is as follows. As I said, the Coulomb potential is the long range, so Prajna example of long range system. And gravity also. And another example is 2D Euler fluid. Because 2D Euler fluid is described by Hamiltonian system, and interaction potential is logarithmic R. And logarithmic R is more or less a mean field. So fluid is this is an example of dimension 2, because we consider just a surface. So the surface is special partial dimension 2, and then interaction potential is alpha equals logarithmic R, but alpha is more or less 0, so fluid is here, and the long range. I'm not sure that Jupiter's the atmosphere is described by the Euler equation or not, but this is just an image of the fluid. Especially around here, because I'm not sure the topology is the sphere in the Jupiter. So, but maybe it is a bit difficult to analyze the fluid mechanics on the sphere because of the topology, topological problem. Okay, so there are some physical example of long-range Hamiltonian system. So potential targets of this talk, like this, so semiconductor and water molecule and ocean and corset, crater and blah. So there are several examples of this topic. So once we say the target is long-range Hamiltonian system, so it seems that it's very restrictive, but not. I think it's not so restrictive. There are many examples. Okay, and then I go to the explanation of the source of one-way fluctuation. And there are many trials to explain the one-way fluctuation. One explanation is the superposition of Lorentzian. So as I said, the Lorentzian does not give one by fluctuation. But if we have several Lorentzian, this one, and this one, and third one, and fourth one, then we have envelope. So envelope may have one by fluctuation, like this figure. But in this case, as I said, one Lorentzian has one time scale. It is gamma. And this Lorentzian has gamma 1, and this Lorentzian gamma 2, gamma 3, gamma 4. So we need several time scales. And the origin of multi-time scale is still unknown. So I do not take this explanation. And second explanation is self-organized fluctuality. It is especially applied for the sand pipe. But now we are concerned in the Hamiltonian system. And this explanation seems not suitable for Hamiltonian system. So I don't take this one also. And the third one is a noise-driven system. So we use stochastic differential equation to derive one by fluctuation. But our target is a deterministic Hamiltonian system. So I don't take that also. Depends on the target system. So for instance, this explanation might be okay for the sand pile. The sand pile gives some kind of one by fluctuation, power type flow. And maybe this one is okay for the sand pile, but not suitable for Hamiltonian system. So I think there are many sources or many mechanisms of one by fluctuation. So this is one of them. And my explanation is especially for the long-range Hamiltonian system. So maybe we have to divide the target to explain the one-way fluctuation, because one-way fluctuation is so ubiquitous, it's too ubiquitous. So maybe there is no universal experience. It might be hard to create a universal experience. So I want a scenario, new scenario, for explaining one by fluctuation in long-range Hamiltonian system. And we propose a new scenario for long-range Hamiltonian system. And the scenario is like this. Existence of pseudo-Casimir-invariants, the unknown word, sorry, the unknown. So, but the scenario is existence of pseudo-Casimir-invariants implies the collective one by fluctuation. So this is a scenario. And the rest of my talk, I explain what is this scenario. And I use a two-step explanation. First step is we start from long-range Hamiltonian system. Then if we consider the long-range Hamiltonian system, we can derive the existence of pseudo-Casimir-invariants. This is the first step. And second step is the numerical scenario. So I show several numerical results to support this scenario. So existence of Casimir invariant implies a collective one-way fluctuation. So first step is the theoretical part. And second step is just I show the numerical supporting evidence. So we start from step one. I start from the explanation of Casimir. What is Casimir invariant? Maybe this is also the unfamiliar word. So we consider the n-body system. So we are considering the Hamiltonian system. So the system is described by position and momentum. Okay? And we consider n particles. And one particle have one position and one momentum. And now we are considering the spatially one-dimensional system for simplicity. And here is a Q, two-dimensional space of Q and P. And the first particle is at Q1 and P1, so I put the point at Q1 and P1 here. And the second particle here at Q2 and P2, so I put the one point Q2 and P2 here, so blah, 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 blah. So I get the end point on this plane. If we take the limit of infinite n, then this behavior can be described by one-body distribution function. So instead of considering the n-body discrete point, we may consider the continuous distribution function. And this description is valid only for long range. So dynamics of n-body system is described by canonical Hamiltonian system and canonical equation of motion. And then corresponding to this canonical equation of motion, this one-body distribution function is described by so-called Vlasov equation. The form is more or less the same. And the difference is here is the n-body Hamiltonian, and here is so-called one-body Hamiltonian. And one-body Hamiltonian is, roughly speaking, is a mean field approximation of n-body Hamiltonian. And so F distribution function F satisfies the Vlasov equation. So in this case, this quantity is invariant motion, constant of motion. The proof is very easy, but I keep it simple. And the important point is this C, we can take any C, any smooth C. For instance, if we take this function C as x power to n, then it gives this so-called Casimir invariant. So x power to n and integrate. This is the invariant motion of this Vlasov equation. So we can take n equal 1, 2, 3, 4, blah, 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 blah. So the Vlasov system has an infinite number of Casimir invariants. OK? So this equation has an infinite number of invariants. OK. So as I said, the Vlasov type description is varied in long range region. So existence of Casimir invariant also varies in long range region. And next, what is pseudo-Casimir invariant? Previously, I took the limit of n from n body system to the n to infinity limit here. So the right-hand side is now zero. But if n, the number of particles, is large but finite, then the right-hand side is no more zero. But there is some small correction, a small term, typically proportional to 1 over n. And it is called a collisional term. So this is called n. Due to this small finite size fluctuation, the collisional term, so Casimir is no more exact. Here, the Casimir invariants are exactly invariant. But now, due to this small term, the Casimir invariant is no more exact, but sure invariant. So this is a concept. Around the, at the center, so the distribution function is high, and around here, the few particles, so the distribution function is low.
Right. So
invariant of time. So if this one is just a function t.
Yes.
So if you take the then it's zero. So if this F satisfies this Vlasov equation, then dt dt equals zero. Okay.
Any function
way. So for instance, this one is okay, so x1, 2, 3 okay, and the logarithm x is okay. So entropy is a constant of motion. Energy is not in this.
Single point.
No, because Hamiltonian energy does not describe this kind of form. No, because H1 is 2 p squared. exists does not directly depend on F. So Hamiltonian integration with each one actually does not conserve in product system. And in another region, the energy, of course, energy conserves in even in the graph of system, but it is another way. Okay, so as I said, if F is satisfied with the Brass equation, the Casimir is exact, but due to this small term, the Casimir is no more exact, but should invariant. So what happened with the should invariant? So this is, I showed one typically phenomenological example. I chose the example of response. So I start from the thermal equilibrium without external force. So here is a thermal equilibrium, but there's no external force. And then I apply small external force. So state here and the force coming here. So this state move a little bit. So this is the thermal equilibrium with external force. But if we have some invariant, so constant of motion, so it is a constraint of dynamics. So this dynamics, so this state wants to go to here by applied force, but due to this constraint, this state cannot go to here, but it goes to here. So response is weakened by constraint. So this is the result for exact constraint. And then what happens with should constraint? Should constraint is like this. So once this state goes to the blue state, but the state recognizes, oh, this constraint is not exact, so I can be free. So after recognizing this, the freeness, this state slowly goes to the goal, the final state there. Okay, so if should constraint is should, this is no more the exact constraint. So state can escape from this constraint. But it is that motion is very slow because of the breaking term is very small. And as a result, we can get this kind of time evolution. So this is this is time. And here is the order parameter of some example. And here is the thermal equilibrium initial level without external force. And the left part is the thermal equilibrium state with external force. And we start from here and apply the external force here. Then system responds to the external force. So initial state here, applying external force, then system goes here. So here. But this state, the trapped state, is not the thermal equilibrium state with external force. But this is a Casimir constrained response level. So it says here. And then, after a long time, the system recognizes, oh, this constraint is not exact, so I can escape from here. So it goes to the thermal equilibrium level, from here to here, slowly, slowly. And then the goal is the thermal equilibrium with external force. So this is a typical temporal evolution with pseudo-Casimir. And another important thing is the lifetime of pseudo-Casimir invariant. This is a result for n to 10 to 3, and 10 to 4, 10 to 5. So we can find if we increase the number of n, the number of particles, then this trapping time increases from here to here. So this panel, small panel shows the scale of time. So I divide t by n. And this n to 4 and n to 5 collapse. So it says that time scale of lifetime of Casimir invariant is order n. this is an example of mean field. So alpha exponent alpha equals there. Okay, so I finished the explanation of the long-range Hamiltonian system, the relation between long-range Hamiltonian system and the existence of pseudo-Casimir impact. So I progressed to the step two. Before going to the numerical result, I explained why we consider the collective one-way fluctuation instead of individual variables. So as I said, this long-range system is described by Vlasov equation. And Vlasov equation is described by the one-body distribution function and one-body Hamiltonian. And one-body Hamiltonian is roughly speaking a mean field approximation of n-body Hamiltonian. So here, important point is here, mean field approximation here. So what is important is the mean field, the collective motion. So we could focus on the collective motion instead of individual motion. Okay, so now I start to show some supporting evidence of this scenario by Q and A psi. And this is a list of questions. So from question one to question six, the question one is long-range system is really important. If the scenario is correct, expected answer is of course yes. And the question two is, should Casimir have a lifetime of order n? So one wave fluctuation should appear in that time scale. Yes or no? Of course, if scenario is correct, we expect yes. And that time we should Casimir for alpha to plus, alpha to minus alpha potential curve as this. Previously, I showed the time scale is order n, but this is for mean field system, so alpha equals zero. So how about if alpha is smaller than d, the long range, then still we have a order lifetime diverge with increasing n or not. And question four is, now we are consider the phase transition, the system having phase transition. And the question four is, phase transition, existence of phase transition is important or not? My scenario does not concern to the existence of phase transition, so expected answer is no. And question five, Hamiltonian nature is important or not? Casimir invariant comes from the Hamiltonian structure of dynamics. So Hamiltonian nature is important. And then last question is, one-way fluctuation in individual variables appear or not? Because we are focusing on collective motion. So how about the individual variables? So expected value, answer is no. So let us check for all six questions. The question one is long range really important or not? To answer this question, we introduce this Hamiltonian system. This is a kinetic term, and this is a potential term, and this S is a Prajna vector, so cosine Q and sine Q. So here is the angle Q, and this S vector sine directed to this direction. And the potential is described by the inner product of Sj and Sk. So this is a so-called XY spin. And this part controls the strength of this strength of interaction. If distance of particle J and particle K is R, then strength of interaction decreases as a function of R power to R alpha. So this alpha controls the strength of range of long interaction. And observable is like this. So we have a n spin. So all the parameter is the average of n spin. observe the square of this order parameter. And this system has, as I said, the phase, second order phase transition. N alpha? Ah, okay. So, in statistical mechanics, potential has the extensive nature. So it means that this potential, order of this potential energy should be order N. Okay? So for instance, if alpha equals zero, then we have N square terms. So we have to divide N to get, it is so-called Kapp prefactor to make the potential extensive. So it is just a small trick, not so important in dynamics. And this one, oh sorry, and this one is this vector rotates on the unit circle, like this. So now the spatial dimension is one. Okay, so because this vector, n vector rotates on the unit circle. So unit circle is dimension one. So now we have p equal one. So d equal one, so if alpha is smaller than one, it is long range. And if alpha is greater than one, it is short range. And what we know is as follows. If alpha is smaller than one, then we have a second order phase transition at the temperature 0.5. And if alpha is greater than 2, there's no phase transition. And there's some phase transition line from here to here, but I'm not sure, and it's not so important, so I describe the line by dotted line, so it's not so clear. So this is the physical nature of this system. To investigate the importance of long-range interaction, I start the alpha dependence of power spectrum. If power spectrum is something like this, so 1 by fluctuation for long range, and but if we increase alpha, it goes down and it becomes a white noise, then it's okay. To start this one, if we take t smaller than 0.5, then we have two phases, ordered phase and disordered phase. But it is complicated. So I decide to investigate over the critical point. So the state is always disordered phase. So we can compare the long range and short range. And the initial condition is like this. So this state is a disordered phase. So the summer equilibrium is described by Maxwell distribution. So with this initial condition, I start the n-body simulation and observe the m square of d, and then we compute the power spectrum. The result is this. So this is the logarithmic frequency, and this is the logarithmic power spectrum, and this red line is alpha equals 0.0, so mean field, very long range. And this one, power spectrum have some straight line part here. So this is a one-way fluctuation. But this power spectrum go down, like from here to here to here to here. And this one is alpha equals 1.0, and after 1.5, it's flat. So this power spectrum is one by type, and the alpha is long range. And this result is for short range interaction, and the power spectrum is white noise. And more precise computation gives this figure. So here is alpha, so there from 0 to 1 and 2. And here is long range, and this is short range. And the difference of point is the difference of number of n, so 32, 1024, 8192. And then the exponent, so I made it this slope for each alpha. And I put the point. So alpha equals 0 gives f power to minus 0.5 here. And then it decreases a bit, and it goes down to 0 in short range interval. Okay? So, you mean the intermediate of F?
No, intermediate of alpha.
Intermediate of
alpha?
Neither short nor long. Here? So if we increase N from here to here to here, it goes down. So I expect in very long, very large N, it goes down here. If we n large enough. So question, answer to the question one is yes, and it is expected one. And question two, 1/f in lifetime of pseudo-Casimir. So pseudo-Casimir have a lifetime of order something, and 1/f fluctuation appear in exactly in such time scale or not. So this is a question two. How to compute this kind of, how to answer for this question? First, I fix the point here. So, time scale, lifetime scale is proportional to order n in mean field, for instance, in mean field. So now we have to research n dependence instead of alpha dependence. Previously, we researched alpha dependence. Now we are interested in the n dependent. So we fix alpha is 0 here, and p is 0.45 for some reason. And then we investigate the n dependent to this direction. And how to identify the lifetime of pseudo-Casimir like this? As I said, the response of the two-step relaxation from this and this, and then from this and this. Similarly, the fluctuation have the same two-step relaxation from here to here. The definition of fluctuation is this. So we start from this point here, and then it starts from fluctuate like this and like this, okay? And then we compute the fluctuation from time 0 to time t. So at time 0, time t equals 0, there's no fluctuation. So fluctuation variance is 0. And then it starts from, it starts to fluctuate. So variance increase like this. And then it goes to the stationary state, something like this. So if we read this time scale, so one oscillation, then we need some level. But after a long time, it starts to escape from Casimir constraint. So it can go this direction also. So fluctuation increase again. So this is a mechanism of two-step relaxation of fluctuation. So from this initial state to this time scale, reaching at the summary equilibrium fluctuation level, Casimir is effective. Because up to this time scale, the dynamics is constrained, still constrained, and does not reach the summary equilibrium fluctuation level. So this is the identification method of the lifetime of Casimir. Choose Casimir invariant. So this is the result for the n dependence, n equal 100, 300, 1000, 3000, and 10,000. And for 100, 1-way fluctuation appears from here to here. So this time scale exactly corresponds to this from here to here. So the f is dimension of f is 1 over time. So this direction corresponds to inverse direction in t. So we have the f shoulder here corresponds to the t shoulder, so red one, 100 is red one, so here, t shoulder. So this is the result of 100, n equals 100, and I change the number of n, 300, still this equality holds, 1,000 still hold, 3,000, and 10,000. So this equality holds for any n, it means that 1 over f fluctuation appear exactly the same time scale of lifetime cosine Casimir, pseudo-Casimir invariant. So the answer to the question 2 is yes. And what about the lifetime of pseudo-Casimir for generic potential? So order n time scale is for alpha equals 0. So I change the alpha, then I investigate the time scale, lifetime scale of pseudo-Casimir. Okay. To investigate this time scale, I've computed the previous time devolution of fluctuation for n equals 1024 and n equals 8192. The number of inside quests is the number of realization for average. And then to get the time scale, I divide it by t by n power to something. And then I start this exponent, which gives a good collapsing of curve. And then result is this. If we choose n power to beta, and beta is proportional 1 minus alpha 2, then all lines are collapsed. So time scale is just n power to minus beta. And beta is 1 minus alpha 2. So alpha equals 0. Previous example is alpha equals 0. So n power to 1 is recovered. And if alpha is 1, it's a boundary of long range and short range, then beta equals 0. So there's no divergence of time scale for in the limit of n infinity. So the answer to the question 3 is so lifetime of pseudo-Casimir for alpha part minus alpha this so diverge only for long range scale. Consistent. And the previous model have the second order phase transition. So I exclude the importance of phase transition from my scenario. To investigate this, to answer this question, I introduced another model. I called it a globally coupled Fermi-Pasta Urmstrung model. And it is this is a kinetic energy term, and this is a potential, and the interaction is quadratic potential and the quadratic potential. And two candidates of quadratic variables are potential energy, so this one, and variance of Q. So variance of Q is the Q square, average of Q square, and the square of Q average.
Because
diverge. So it means that we cannot reach the thermal equilibrium. We cannot reach the thermal equilibrium. So I go back to this expression. Where is this one? Point time. So that term is infinite. So this system cannot go to the thermal equilibrium. So this one is an example of response, but even in the non-response system, the system cannot reach the thermal equilibrium because of the convergence, long range and convergence of Casimir-invariants. So if initial state have a different value of Casimir level value from this goal thermal state, then this initial state never go to the thermal equilibrium state. So it comes from the incommutativity of two limits. The two limits is n go to infinite and t go to infinite. So in normal statistical mechanics, we take t go to infinite first. So we consider the first the system goes to thermal equilibrium. Then we take n go to infinite. Okay, but now we consider n go to infinite first. Then Casimir-invariant eternally holds. So even if we take t to infinite, it does not go to the thermal equilibrium. So it happens for alpha smaller than one. Thank you for help. So now this part is breaks the Casimir-invariant, but this one is typically proportion one way. So if we take one way, n goes to infinite, it binds, so Casimir becomes exact. Classification is valid only for long range. So in short range, some coefficients to derive the Brass equation, we have some coefficients. And this coefficient converges only for long range case. And in short range case, the coefficient diverge, so equation does not have meaning. Okay. So as we start, the new question, this one. So we have two candidates of collective variables. So what we expect is that these collective variables have one by fluctuation. Because this system have no phase transition, but the scenario does not take care about the existence of phase transition. So let's check. But there's no one way fluctuation for energy potential, a potential energy, and variance of qubits. It's almost quite none. So there's a scenario break. So I consider GP. And the oracle of scenario is observe angle variable. One body Hamiltonian is now integrable system. The integrable system have angle and action variable. So angle variable, this one, angle variable. Intuitively, this is almost the same. So now we are considering the almost harmonic potential. So phase space is such like this, Q and P, and motion is such like this. And the angle variable is more or less this angle. So instead of potential energy and Q, variance of Q, we consider this kind of order parameter, more or less similar with the previous model. Then we consider the time series of this and this variable and compute the power spectrum. And the result is this. So So we recover the 1 by fluctuation. So for n equals 100, 1000, 10,000, for the real and the variable, and this is the imitation variable. Imitation means that real variable is not this variable, but this is the imitation, one imitation and the variable. So for real and the variable and the imitation and the variable is the 1 by fluctuation. So the happiness of this scenario is the scenario extracts a hidden 1 by fluctuation. This one is observable, and these observables are not suitable to observe 1 by fluctuation. Honestly saying, I don't know the exact reason, but my understanding is like this. So the Casimir level set is like this. And then this suitable variable is tangent of this constraint. So if this tangency does not hold, then it becomes difficult to extract 1 by fluctuation. So the question for the answer to the question 4 is no, as expected. Okay. And that's the questions are not so hard. Is Hamiltonian nature important or not? So I introduce another model. So this one is proposed HNF. So the previous model have the alpha dependent, but if alpha equals 0, then we say that it is Hamiltonian mean field model. And this is a so-called Kuramoto model. And this model is derivative of time is 1, or first order. So this is not a Hamiltonian system. But phenomenologically, this model has a phase transition at this critical energy. And this Kuramoto model has something at the phase transition at the critical point of this coupling constant. If coupling constant is large enough, then it starts to the synchronize. So phenomenologically, this system and this system gives a similar phenomenon. And we can define the similar order parameter. So we observe the square root of this order parameter in this Kuramoto model. So if the Hamiltonian nature is so important, the phenomenology are similar, but this power spectrum, this quantity, should not have 1 by fluctuation. So I said, the result is like this. So we have 3 points. So we have 3 points in the non-synchronized here. Sorry. This is inverse. Sorry. So this one should be here. So this is a non-synchronized homogeneous state. And this is a synchronized cluster state. And I took just a critical point. So I took 3 points. And for 3 points, the first spectrum is this. So slope minus 2 is here. So there is no 1 by F fluctuation in Kuramoto model. So the answer to the question 5 is yes. And the last question is individual variable have 1 by fluctuation or not? It's very easy. Huh? Kuramoto model? For Kuramoto model? Kuramoto model is in the limit of n to infinite. Kuramoto model is described by equation of continuity. No Brasov. And so Brasov system have the Hamiltonian nature, and the equation of continuity have no Hamiltonian nature. And this Hamiltonian nature nature is very important to prove the conservation of Casimir invariants. So this one is also described by distribution function, but due to the difference of the mathematical structure, there is no Casimir invariants.
So I would not have
this is consistent with our scenario. And last question is an individual variable. To check this, instead of the order parameter, I compute the power spectrum of individual cosine at Q1, just only one particle. And the result is this, flat, white noise, no 1/5 fluctuation. So collective variable, order parameter is important to observe 1/5 fluctuation. So this is a list of the questions and answers that we check them, all questions, and they all answers support the scenario. Okay? So take home messages like this, the existence of pseudo-Casimir-invariants induced collective 1/5 fluctuations. So pseudo-Casimir is a bit the mathematical, very hard, quantity, but the concept of pseudo-invariants may be useful in other systems. For instance, if we consider the hard spring is like this. So if spring is hard, energy of this this spring it does not transport to other degrees of freedom. So energy of this hard spring is more or less a pseudo-invariant. We can apply this concept of pseudo-invariant to other systems. So this is a take-home message. So this is the last slide, the references of anomaly by pseudo-Casimir. So due to the existence of pseudo or just exact Casimir, we have several anomalous phenomena. For instance, critical exponent for response have the different critical exponent from the statistical mechanics. And finite such fluctuation also matters, and this one is the threshold. Thank you for your attention. Very difficult to make collapse the graph. So this estimation is maybe valid for only for alpha smaller than.